least find a lot to do, watch something.
We're gonna, I think, wait 5 minutes for, I think there was about a million people outside waiting for lunch, or trying to eat their lunch. But I thought I would, at least before my lecture, I saw a lovely part of our video being shown. I thought I would show you a video of our intraoperative MRI that... So I'm gonna, this video is gonna actually show intraoperative MRI that I have, probably the first surgeon in the world to use intraop MR and intraop PET CT. So I'm just gonna have this play in the background, and I can maybe narrate this. So what we developed at the Brigham Women's, and we had just seen a piece of this being shown by the IMRIS system. So we actually have an operating room that has both a PET CT and a 3-Tesla MRI built into it, and we actually have done now, I've done 42 cases with the use of intraop MRI to look at margin assessment, and we've added mass spec and many other fun toys and tools and gadgets, and I think this is just somewhat entertaining for folks to see. So as part of protocol, we're looking at women with early stage breast cancer. They get a breast MR that is traditionally done diagnostic and prone. And what we end up doing is then on the day of surgery, she actually gets a supine breast MR done under general anesthesia. So you just saw this video. This is actually our OR. We were the first to have it. That's my patient undergoing anesthesia with intraoperative MRI. So as you know, that any woman who's diagnosed with breast cancer, they always get their MRIs prone, but we obviously always operate on them supine. And we'll have some publications coming out showing it is remarkably different, the location of the tumor when she's looked at from prone to supine, plus there's a big change in tumor size, sterosity. So this is my patient undergoing pre-op MR assessment. We have our, this is me and my fellow, marking out the incisions. She's prepped and draped just like she is in any other standard operating room. I always do my sentinel nodes with methylene blue, and it's just because it's cheap and fast, and it's cost in the United States methylene blue, $2.50, I think, roughly. I obviously vigorously massage, and I need to see that the EKG is almost causing VTAC in terms of the monitoring. I'll do my sentinel node first. This is with my fellow who's now on staff at MD Anderson. We do the sentinel node biopsy, and then these images are being now recreated on the the supine MR that we had done. Then we go and do our lumpectomy like we would do in any other operating room. And what we do is both a pre-procedure MRI and a post-procedure MRI to look at margins, and we're also doing intraoperative mass spectrometry and a few other things. So once my lumpectomy is performed, I temporarily close the cavity, fill it in with saline. This is not how I usually close the breast, but because we're going to reopen it, we fill the breast cavity with saline to the volume of the tumor that was resected, which was pre-imaging calculated for us. So then what happens is all of our equipment is removed, the MR comes in, and then we do intraoperative MR after the lumpectomy to look at the margin. So this is that same patient with the MR being performed. The MR machine is now being, leaves the room. One side, we have the image, again, supine tumor, and then on the opposite side, we have the image after resection, looking at for any areas of enhancement. And then we take shaved margins of any areas that look suspicious at the same time. So it's, again, a very fancy tool and gadgets. Again, we've done this for about 40 patients with intraop breast MR. We've added PET CT, mass spec, and a million other little toys and gadgets. And again, the purpose of Amino is not to build MRs for in all the operating. This is way too expensive. And all the studies for surgeons that have shown that MRI has not reduced re-excision, I think one of the fatal flaws potentially could have been that every breast MR is done prone, and I've never operated on the breast prone in my life, and it's always done supine. And the breast is not a fixed organ, and if you flip the patient over to her back, that tumor and breast changes its location and the tumor's size quite a bit. And if you're going to use MR for surgical planning, you're going to want to do it in the right direction. So we've actually added supine breast MR sequences now to our diagnostic breast MRIs as part of a trial. So my goal is not to build these fancy operating rooms all over the world, but to use it as a test bed to come up with ideas to take it outside of Amigo. And if you want, I can start the lecture now. This is just more for waiting for people to come back. So, I'd like to thank the moderators of this session specifically, and obviously Professor Schaumann, the organizing committee, for the invitation to speak. They wanted me to talk about neoadjuvant therapy and some considerations and challenges for the surgeon. This is just our two institutes. When you're looking at the screen on the left, it's the Brigham and Women's Hospital, on the right, Dana-Farber, and unlike some other cancer centers in the United States, Our outpatient therapy is done at Dana-Farber, but all the inpatient beds and surgery is done at the Brigham and Women's, and it's connected by a bridge. And I think I've shown this breast MR in other talks, is that there is a large what seems to be unicentric triple-negative breast cancer on sagittal imaging on breast MR, and then she gets neoadjuvant therapy and goes to the below image. Well, what do you do? That's great. That's a wonderful response here. You know, this patient was treated with cisplatinum and bevacizumab as one of our local therapy trials that we had in Boston. But then as a surgeon or as a patient, what do you do? Do you do a mastectomy? Do you do a lumpectomy? What are you going to excise if you're going to do a lumpectomy? Do you take out the entire tumor bed, or do you just go for a smaller area where maybe the clip was? I think this is an area that still requires a lot of thoughts in terms of what to do next. So what we do know is for neoadjuvant therapy is that it's we can surgically downstage a primary tumor, and then with the results of both prospective trials and retrospective studies, it does provide effective systemic adjuvant therapy. There are some potentials, which I think we haven't really been able to show quite as well, is identifying biomarkers that can predict long-term treatment option and outcomes and potentially individualizing our treatment of patients. So I'm going to go over a little bit on breast-conserving therapy, if it's going to happen after neoadjuvant therapy. The axilla, I'm just going to spend a very short period of time on. And if you're going to do breast-conserving therapy, what are the considerations, and then those undergoing mastectomy. So at least in the United States, and I know the disease process here in Egypt, and again in the Middle East and North African countries, that they present with more advanced disease, but inflammatory breast cancer, locally advanced breast cancer, the numbers are much lower. Traditionally, it's either been chemotherapy, endocrine therapy, or a combination with targeted therapy that's been to reduce the size of the tumor. And in the past, many decades ago, it was almost always followed by a mastectomy. This is a patient of mine who presented to a clinic where they were felt that she was being treated with for mastitis by her gynecologist with several cycles of antibiotics without treatment. She underwent an MRI. You can see there is skin thickening, nipple retraction, a lot of enhancement that occupies the vast majority of her central breast. A very generous punch biopsy was performed, and you can see tumor, the lymphatics filled with tumor. So I think in the neoadjuvant therapy, the standard of care could be a core biopsy, punch biopsy. You want to determine she has cancer, dermal lymphatic invasion. You want the receptors. You will treat them with neoadjuvant therapy. Fortunately, the vast majority of these patients in 2016 now will respond. Outside of clinical trial, and I know of one or two trials that are underway, I still think that the standard of care currently is a modified radical mastectomy. I don't see much of a role for a sentinel node currently in the inflammatory setting for a few reasons. One is if you try to do the sentinel node up front, which we don't do much anymore, their lymphatics are clogged with tumor, and it almost ends up never traveling to the lymph nodes, and the vast majority of these patients end up being node positive. Their risk of local regional failure is extremely high. So at least in my patient population and in our institution, we still do a modified radical mastectomy, followed by radiation and if appropriate targeted or endocrine therapy. But outside of those that have inflammatory breast cancer, how about with those with operable or locally advanced breast cancer? The rationale was to increase breast-conserving therapy rates. There was some preclinical data suggesting potentially improvement in survival. There have been many studies, both randomized and non-randomized, that have shown a reduction in mastectomy rates. Although at the end, I'm going to present data in the modern era in the United States and in Europe where maybe that's not necessarily the case. And that really there's been no difference in overall survival, disease progression, or distant recurrence. Early on, there's some conflicting data on local regional failure, but we'll go over why that's the case. This was a review done at the JNCI of 9 randomized trials of nearly 4,000 patients. Again, no difference in death or disease progression. There was a suggestion potentially of higher local regional failure in the neoadjuvant arm, but that actually included patients that underwent either no surgery or surgery without radiation, and if you gave appropriate radiation, there was really no difference. And because of the various regimens, the response rates varied quite a bit. The majority of the patients from this review came from the SAVPB18 and the EORTC-10902. And I think what that suggested at that time is that surgery remains essential in management, and radiation therapy alone cannot be considered a substitute. Certainly, we're learning now how tumors respond to neoadjuvant therapy. There are those, for example, that the triple negatives, where I see them concentrically shrinking quite a bit, but potentially those that are ER positive or HER2 positive, that their response tends to be different. And I think we should really look beyond PathCR and breast-conserving therapy rates and look at imaging and molecular markers, potentially identifying our non-responders early, tailoring their therapy, and improving results. And that's something I don't think we're there yet, either as an oncology community or a surgical community. So I think in terms of individualizing treatments, will that alter surgical therapy and potentially could it change long-term tumor control and outcomes? And if you're going to do this, at what time points and how are you going to measure it? Is it mammogram, ultrasound, physical exam, breast MR, you know, some other imaging modality? This is review for, I'm sure, everyone here, but NSABPB18, looking at operable breast cancer, randomizing to surgery followed by 4 cycles of Adriamycin Cytoxan, or the reverse, 4 cycles of Adriamycin Cytoxan followed by surgery. And I think the importance of this was that there was an increase in breast conservation in the United States from 60 to 68%, a downstaging of the axilla, unfortunately no difference in disease-free overall survival, and no statistical difference in breast recurrence, but there was the beginnings of some inclinations of PathCR and long-term outcome. And NSABPB18 did not sit alone. Trials from the Institute Curie and Royal Marsden done at the same time showed, again, pretty much equivalence in terms of overall survival, disease-free survival, increase in general breast-conserving therapy rates, no real difference in breast recurrence. So if it was felt that if 4 cycles of Adriamycin Cytoxan was better, potentially giving more chemotherapy prior to surgery, would that improve our breast-conserving therapy rates? And in B27, the addition of 4 cycles of docetaxel, although we saw a near doubling of our PathCR rate from 13 to 25%, there really was no difference in breast conservation. And now in the modern era, both the FDA and our European counterparts have begun to recognize that PathCR is a surrogate endpoint and potentially super suitable for more rapid approval of newer therapies. So this is a typical preoperative therapy regimen. You get multiple cycles of chemotherapy with multiple points of assessment followed by surgery, radiation, and if appropriate, it's extended antibiologic therapy with anti-HER2, for example, or anti-estrogen therapy. In terms of what modalities to use when you find a patient that's undergoing neoadjuvant therapy, certainly we all do physical exam, but how accurate is physical exam? And then is it standardized how you do physical exam? Even in our 11 or 12 breast surgeons that we have right now, some people will use their fingers, others will use calipers, tape measures, and the correlation coefficient of what the physical exam size to tumor size is not superbly great, and whether that's done in the adjuvant setting or neoadjuvant setting, the correlation coefficients vary quite a bit in the literature. Mammogram, I still do this, and I think it should still be standard for patients undergoing neoadjuvant therapy, at least at the start of neoadjuvant therapy, and certainly if you're going to offer breast conservation afterwards. But in terms of how accurate it is, again, the correlation coefficients of what the size of mammography is to pathology is not superbly accurate. Ultrasound in the United States is very operator dependent. There are excellent correlation from our Asian counterpart radiologists because they do a lot more ultrasound screening. There's difficulty with long-lived breast cancer, and again, the correlation coefficients are not wonderful. So this is a patient of mine who presented with a fairly large tumor. There's looks like pathologic lymph nodes with no real fatty hilum in the axilla. And on ultrasound, it looks like it's a large cancer. So can we do better? In the neoadjuvant setting, I do use breast MRI. Certainly at the time, it was a newer imaging modality. There is a lot of issues with the technique. Are you using a 1.5, 3 Tesla, 0.5 Tesla magnet, the fat suppression, the software, the expertise of your evaluation. But almost every study has suggested that the correlation coefficient of MR to final pathology size is more accurate. So this takes that same patient I showed you 2 slides ago, And it shows it a little bit different. This is that same tumor, and you see some non-mass-like enhanced enantiomers in the tumor. So what is that? Is that GCIS? Is it from a core biopsy? Is it something else? In this case, we had our radiologist core, and we clipped the anterior and posterior extent of this tumor, which we really don't do much anymore. We usually have to try to put a clip towards the center of the tumor. But interestingly, in this case, after neoadjuvant therapy, the response of the tumor, so there's no more real enhancement of the tumor bed, but this tumor elastosis and response kind of pushed my clips, or not my clips, but the radiologist's clips, this patient's clips out. So originally, when we started doing breast conserving therapy, we didn't know what to take out. Do we take out the entire tumor bed? Do we take out both clip sites? Do I just go for what's in between? And I think, I know personally in our group, maybe a decade and a half ago, certainly over-treated these tumors. We took a lot more tissue, in this case it was GCIS with microinvasion and clear margins, but did I really need to do a lumpectomy this big? And I think the answer to that is no. This takes a patient in the more modern era where there's a larger tumor in this breast and it has a lot of a non-mass-like enhancement around it. Afterwards, she's had a very nice response, and I know I'm switching imaging modalities, but there's all these very ugly-looking calcifications. So in this case, would I do a mastectomy? If I'm going to do a lumpectomy, do I have to remove all these calcifications to prove that there's no DCIS there? Do I just go for the clip site? And in this case, I resected a much smaller amount. I can guarantee I left calcifications behind that span much more larger distance than what this bed shows. But and I take shaped margins as part of my standard practice, and there was no residual cancer, no residual DCIS. I felt comfortable with this patient undergoing radiation therapy. And this, I think this woman's now like 7-8 years out from her therapy. There's no evidence of local regional failure. So our neoadjuvant imaging guidelines is baseline mammogram, ultrasound, and MRI, core biopsy, and clip identification of the tumor site. Looking at the axilla, and I know that was addressed in earlier talks, as I said, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. Axillary ultrasound plus or minus FNA or core biopsy, abnormal looking lymph nodes. At the completion of neoadjuvant therapy, we work. If the patient's not undergoing mastectomy, I would repeat the same imaging modalities. I would not pick and choose which ones you like, unless you have good data to show that one is better than the other. And then work closely with our imaging colleague, whether it's wire or seat placement in coordination with reconstruction in case you don't achieve clear margins, and certainly with radiation oncology. This kind of goes over the summary of kind of what I've discussed. But before I give up the podium, I'm going to transfer to an oral presentation I gave at ASCO this past year. And if we're going to give neoadjuvant therapy, are we really doing the patients a favor in the United States? And every talk starts with neoadjuvant therapy, that we're increasing our breast-conserving therapy rates. But I'm going to show, I think, in the modern era of the United States and potentially in certain parts of Europe, that that's not necessarily the case. So we ran two trials through CLGB, which is Cancer and Leukemia Group B, now part of Alliance. One was a phase 3 trial for HER2-positive breast cancer, CLGB-40601, which has been presented and published in JCO, and 40603, which is a phase 2 trial for triple-negative breast cancer presented at San Antonio and published in JCO, and their primary endpoint was in breast path CR. But we developed in both studies the exact same surgical sub-study. One was to prospectively document the impact of neoadjuvant therapy on eligibility of breast conservation, record the choice of surgery in achieving negative margins, and we'll go over what the negative margins were there, and correlation with breast-conserving therapy and path CR. So CLGB-40601 was our HER2-positive trial, three arms, which I don't need to spend a lot of time on, randomizing to one of these three arms, surgery, and then followed by dose-dense adriamycin, cytoxan, and urotrastuzumab. This was Lisa Carey's study, again, presented at ASCO. And Bill Sykov ran our 40603, which was a 2x2 factorial design, which we won't spend any time on, but you can see lots of chemotherapy given for these triple-negative breast cancer, the primary endpoint, path CR, presented at San Antonio, published in JCO, followed by surgery, radiation therapy, and no recommendation for adjuvant therapy. Most of these patients were stage 2, about a third stage 3, and the very similar in terms of median age across both studies was 49. The majority of these women were premenopausal. Nearly 3/4 or 2/3 to 3/4 were high grade. As expected, 90% would be ductal histology. And so what we asked the surgeon, and they had to document, is this patient a candidate for breast-conserving therapy prior to neoadjuvant therapy, yes or no? And if not, document the reason why. Same question after neoadjuvant therapy, and then the definitive surgery was left at the discretion of the patient. When we looked at our nearly 700 patients, prior to neoadjuvant therapy, 340 were felt to be candidates for breast-conserving therapy, about half of our patients. After the neoadjuvant therapy, 90% of those patients remained candidates, which is great. About half of our patients were not candidates, and then after neoadjuvant therapy, about 40% became candidates for breast-conserving therapy. If you went down the route of breast conservation, meaning that you stayed in the arm that was candidates before and after, and you attempted breast conservation in the United States, that was 3/4 of the patients, and it was successful 90% of the time. Of those 42% of patients who were changed from non-candidates to candidates, 2/3 had breast-conserving therapy attempted, and 85% was successful. When we looked at reasons for non-candidacy, we would expect prior to neoadjuvant therapy, tumor to be too large, probable poor cosmetic outcome to be the reasons why. And then after neoadjuvant therapy, those numbers of those patients significantly decreased, but things that really wouldn't change that much, suspicious microcalcifications, multicentric disease really didn't change. When we looked at path CR by arm, there was a difference between those who were considered candidates both before and after neoadjuvant therapy at 58% versus those who were never candidates before and after breast-conserving therapy. But you can see, to me, this means that 42% of patients, 58% of patients had a path CR if they were considered candidates for breast-conserving therapy both before and after. But if you felt that the patient was not a candidate, yet almost 42 to almost the same number were able to achieve path CR. So there is truly a reason, there's a problem in the US on why this occurs. What was the main reason for breast-conserving therapy? Like the NeoAlto study, we showed that being a candidate prior to neoadjuvant therapy was the most significant factor. And what we ended up showing is that, again, if you took half of our patients who were not candidates, we increased the number of patients who were breast-conserving therapy candidates from about 50% to 66%. If you underwent attempted breast-conserving therapy, it's very likely to work. However, overall, less than half of our patients underwent breast conservation.